Bueno, aquí estamos con nuestro amigo Gustavo. Mi nombre es José. Estamos aquí en el podcast de TECH23 en un restaurante colombiano, porque la bandera de nuestro guest es
Colombia.
Estar con un cafecito. So, saludo. ¿Cómo?
¿El café tiene aguardiente o es solo café?
No tiene aguardiente.
No, okay, no. Entonces este no me lo voy a tomar, ¿no? Y es muy común de por sí. En la región cafetera.
Sí.
Y en la región paisa de Colombia, Medellín y demás. Me han contado, yo no soy de Medellín, quiero ser muy respetuoso con mis amigos paisas. Sí, aguardiente, los abuelos y las abuelas se toman su aguardientico en la mañana, lo mezclan con café y arrancan el día.
Estamos hablando de tech y quería saber cómo llegaste a ser un tech founder too. Entonces, la industria de tech es muy grande, hay gente que está programando, people that are like spend all day just coding their apps and their software, but you actually help create jobs, which is awesome, especially in this economy right now. So tell us about being a tech founder.
Yeah, well, it was actually very interesting, and I think that over the years, I was able to understand, Jose, that that business, it just becomes a lifestyle. Yeah. There is not an on and off switch, even though that I tell my wife the opposite, that yeah, I'm able to control my schedule, blah, blah, blah. No, you're always thinking, you're always in that business, in the strategy, in thinking about the next move, what can happen and how you can actually organize the next 2-3 steps.
Okay.
So that to say that because of that career and that choice in life, then business organically comes to you and not the other way around. If that makes some sort of sense.
A little bit, but okay. So actually I have a quick question about the tech part. Most, again, just because most people think tech means I know how to code and program, I'm gonna ask you, do you know how to code?
Absolutely not.
is that in your plans or anything?
Maybe not. I think a lot of times we think that we need to have knowledge in every field. I think the opposite. I think that we need to specialize in our strengths.
Okay.
Focus on our strengths, be good and better every single day on our strengths. And then once you develop that, then everybody else will be able to fill in the gaps on your weakness.
Gotcha.
And I mean, we talk a lot about being a team player, right?
Yes.
Well, that's really what it is. So my forte is the vision, is the strategy. It's pushing things forward no matter what.
Gotcha.
Once I jump into a project, it's going to go through.
Perfect.
Bottom line.
And I know that a lot of non-tech founders usually have their opposite, being the tech person, the one that probably knows how to code and can review that. So that's great to know that we're sitting here with somebody that says, I'm in tech as a founder. I'm not the one coding, but I'm setting myself with the team, the right people that do it, so that if somebody's out there and they have a great idea that can be solved with technology, they don't have to stop just like you did. You can just, somebody needs to do what you do, right? Like push it forward no matter what.
If you were to ask me maybe 2 years ago if I had in my near term journey to be part of technology, that was something that I was like, well, I don't know how to code. I'm not a coder. I don't even know if that's ever going to happen. So it never crossed my mind. And then next thing you know, but again, it's a mind's game. It's all in your head. And then next thing you know, it came to being part of organizations that they are very involved in tech. I'm actually part of this organization, which is a national network. It's a huge support system for Latino entrepreneurs, and it's in the heart of technology in Silicon Valley. So of course you're part of those conversations, and yeah, Next thing you know, they're dragging you and dragging you and dragging you to where we have what we call Trez today, and that's our startup.
And show us, I know you're wearing it, so show
absolutely
us here.
The Superman logo, yeah. No, so Trez is actually the first Latino payroll platform for Hispanic-owned businesses in the United States. So we are actually making history. Yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you. It's a historical moment, not just for us, but it's a historical moment also for the entire Latino community in the United States. We represent over 5 million small businesses, the fifth largest GDP in the world, if we were to be a country, right? And all the data that many of you know, well, Trez, it's basically saying in the payroll industry, now we are the market. We're using payroll every single day. Yeah. Hispanic-owned businesses are using
payroll. Even this restaurant we're in here right now.
Now that we are the market, how about we become the creators?
Yes.
And that's really what we are pushing for today.
Thank you so much for saying we become the creators, because Latinos, we're such a huge consumers of tech. And I don't think they realize, because I was actually having this conversation con mis papás el otro día. Les dije, oye, ustedes usan Netflix, ustedes usan Gmail, ustedes usan, pues todas las computadoras son Microsoft. We're a Microsoft family. We haven't moved over to Apple, so.
Same.
So tenemos eso. Pero les digo, but we're not necessarily the creators of it, right? Like we're starting to, and that's great. So with Tech23, actually, that's one of the main things that we want to do. Queremos enseñarle a la gente que pues tú puedes hacer un creator. También tienes una idea por una mejor un mejor Netflix o un mejor email o un mejor, como dices, you were probably using, I don't know, ADP or some other system, but you found a better way, more relatable to the mercado, to the Latino market, and that's awesome that you're creating that. And that's the feeling or the energy that we want to create more and more of para toda nuestra gente latina.
We are already the consumers. Now we're transitioning into becoming the actual makers, the creators of the technology. And who understands the Latino community more than us?
Nadie.
Correct, but that's not represented in the boardrooms. Correct. That's not represented in the leadership. And it's not that, hey, you need to add us because we're Latinos. No. You need to add us into the conversation because it's good for business.
Si.
If you are marketing your product to 20-30% of the market, which is Latino, and you don't have anybody that can relate to that market, then guess what? You're losing money. So it's the right.
No, 100%.
But anyways, it can go in different, many different
places. Si se puede hacer un salucita con el café, para que haya más, we're the first Latino XYZ. Que haya muchos más
Absolutely.
De estas conversaciones.
Absolutely.
Para todos los Latinos allá, we're that hundreds of you get to say, we're the first Latino, y ya pues siguen en lo que siga la compañía de tech.
So yes, it is an invitation for many out there that you need to pull the trigger.
So you're already on this side. Let's go back to before you were a tech founder, pero ese espíritu de founder, you've always had it as an entrepreneur. So can you walk us down the line of some of your entrepreneurial positions?
Well, the first one is when I was selling candies and shining shoes in middle school. I think it's something that, you know, each one of us have a talent. And there is no right or wrong talent. Mm-hmm. I think it's about embracing that talent and developing that talent and growing with the talent throughout your journey in life. So my talent, I think it was being always in the very thin line and being a risk taker and finding opportunities and being consistent with those opportunities, being consistent in the messaging. And that started by selling candies to other classmates in school.
I'm curious, yo soy mexicano, ¿qué tipo de dulces son los tradicionales que vendían? What was your best product?
Mira, realmente no recuerdo exactamente qué dulces, porque era más el concepto que el producto como tal. Pero era, imagínate, you go to like a Costco, right? And you buy wholesale, and then you do the math, and you're like, okay, well, each one of these candies, they're selling it at school for, let's say, $1, right? But I can actually do exactly the same. If I buy the bulk, my cost is going to be 10 cents, meaning that I can totally sell it for 50 cents and make five times the money.
Yeah.
So that's how my brain, you know, started working to take something, make a profit, don't go and blow it, and then from there, scale it. But yeah, that's
funny que dices pues de los dulces, porque también pasa en México. Aquí, porque pues ya ves en Houston, ahorita es que estamos aquí, hay mucho mexicano, y nosotros vendíamos los dulces. Yo también iba a La Pulga y compraba la bolsa de paletas, de chicles, de todo lo que tenía chile, porque that's not something you would find at the local grocery store, right? So we would sell it, I don't know, the bag for like $5, and then, you know, you'd sell each paleta for like 75 cents or something. So I would go home also with a pocket full of change, and I think the candy story unites a lot of Latinos. So shout out to all the los que venden dulces ahí en Latino America.
Well, and that's also another thing that it's an invitation for all of us and a reflection. We need to start investing on the invisible. how about we start investing on the people who are selling a la pulga? We start investing on the people who are part of our communities and that are on the making and that have a future and that have the grit. We already know those ingredients for success. Yes.
I believe some of the best salesmen in the world están en las pulgas. And if given the right opportunity, if you, hey, venden serruchos, venden overoles, venden pantalones, jeans, whatever, but if you, maybe you give them a Trez product, then, you know, probably some of your best salespeople.
Well, think about this. A lot of times, some of these people, they don't even like selling. It was not a choice.
Yeah.
Some of them, the ones that don't like selling, it happened to be that they're the best at selling because they're talented, right? And then the other variable that plays a factor is that they are in survival mode.
So Gustavo, you mentioned struggle, and I think struggle is something that unites a lot of Latinos coming into this country. Sí, yo he aprendido de ti y de otra gente que son de Centro y Suramérica que la historia es un poquito diferente que la del mexicano, porque a veces yo siempre pensé que pues no todos cruzaron por el río, ¿verdad? Fue es una historia diferente, pero también y este podcast este podcast lo queremos usar para enseñar esas historias para los mexicanos también y todos, que yo sé que parte de lo que yo conozco de tu cultura quizás son los estereotipos de like being Colombian, right? And that's because I haven't really traveled to Colombia and learned it, so I'm glad I have somebody here. But let's talk about the story. So you made it from Colombia to was it Houston your first place? Or
yeah, I actually landed here at the age of 17. I came for the summer vacation, right? It was actually my first time leaving the country, right? And my wife, who is Eastern European, she's like, what do you mean you never left the country? I'm like, no, it was very expensive. And even though that I was my childhood, we were in sort of a mid-high socioeconomic level in Colombia. My dad, I was fortunate that he was actually part of oil and gas. He was part of corporate world. So I always was very intrigued on escalating the ladder, you know, on like learning more about all that kind of stuff. But anyway, so in my case, I didn't have the need to leave out of my comfort zone. I could have stayed in Colombia. I could have also continued my college education down there. But there was something inside of me that told me you need to leave. You need to get out.
Yeah.
Now I was able to understand the get out of your comfort zone and blah, 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 blah. But it was really deep inside of me. And that's whenever I moved to the United States at the age of 17 back in 2004. So yes, I'm 35 still. And then from there, it was business and business and business and business ventures ever since. So before that was a little bit ashamed of. I don't have a college education back then, right? And while everybody else is going to college, while everybody else is going to college parties, while everybody else is going to spring break parties, while everybody else is having these teens and college life, I was running businesses. I was struggling. I was like literally breaking into little pieces because I had literally no money. That was like my common denominator. I was broke every single day, every single time. So, but then when you allow time to let you digest and to let you think, see things from a different perspective, then you can say today, well, I actually have over 17 years of a small business experience. At the age of 35, yeah, that is powerful.
I know your heart. It's just like, I just want people to continue to grow and help. So I know that you did actually a really cool business here that a lot of Latinos really get into it, which was fixing car stereos, right? Can you tell us about when you were in that industry, like kind of pimping out people's rides?
Yeah, I know, absolutely. That was a transition between business A, which it was a dollar store, and that was actually a family business. But I mean, I call it family business, but in reality, they just threw me there, and it was my business, right? Purchasing every single little thing. I had literally no one else to support those businesses, which at some point I'm like, this is not fair. But now I understand that that was what got me to where I am today. And I still believe that my career is just barely getting started. The dollar store, I was actually on my knees cleaning all the inventory, setting up the store, getting into the warehouse. There were also rats going through it, having somebody that just showed up and say, hey, can I help? Yeah. And yeah, sure, absolutely. And just building that community within the store to where the opportunity came across to sell, we were able to exit, right? And it was a successful exit, but it all played not only in the numbers, not only sustaining the business, making the business profitable, but also the little details.
Y me encanta que dijiste la word exit, because now you only hear it in like tech startups, like, oh, we're building towards an exit, but you exited out of a dollar store.
Absolutely, and here's the other thing, and I exited also from the other business. The second one was not a nice exit. It was actually like shutting down, like not filing for bankruptcy specifically, but shutting doors down. And that was probably one of the toughest decisions that I ever had to go through in business. But somebody had to literally had a meeting with investors, with partners, with everybody and say, enough is enough, right? And I am the type of person that I love to hit myself in the wall and the wall and the wall and the wall and the wall until I break it. Yeah. But it is okay also to set a pause and to say enough is enough. Yeah, moments when your electricity is being shut down at home during the summertime while you have your little sister and she's like maybe 4 or 5 back then because my parents moved temporarily from Colombia to the U.S., and getting a call, for example, from someone like your mom and saying, hey, there is no electricity.
Se fue la luz.
Se fue la luz. Pero no se debe que están haciendo alguna reparación en la zona o algo. And meanwhile, I'm like, no, I know what happened. Yeah. Like, we did not pay electricity because we didn't have money to pay electricity. And meanwhile, this is when the moms and the Latinas are so powerful and so amazing.
Yes.
Because when I got home, mi mamá tenía una barbecue.
Sí.
Right? Y tenía ahí carbón y ella misma le puso, lo encendió y todo lo demás. Y arriba tenía la rejita y ahí puso una olla pequeñita and she was making us rice. Now, it was very difficult, especially for us, when you come from a socioeconomic level to where everything is perfect, to where back home you are rich, if you want to put it that way, and you never had to go through that kind of stuff, and then you get to see your mom doing that. Yes, that's tough. I mean, it's very rough.
Y like, cheers para las mamás latinas, porque son uno de los individuos más fuertes en este mundo, yo creo que Dios, o todas las mamás, honestamente, porque escuchas muchas historias de que la pobreza es la hermana de la innovación. And that's so beautiful, porque dices, hey, no había luz, pero tu madre, ¿qué importa? Like, I have to figure this out, tenemos que comer, and I love that. Y creo que ese espíritu vive en muchos latinos.
Yo creo que hay maneras también de no tener que pasar por sufrimiento. Yes. No es necesario sufrir para poder llegar a ciertos puntos, y eso lo podemos eliminar por medio o reducir por medio de la colaboración. ¿Sí? En ese momento yo no tenía ningún tipo de apoyo en términos de apoyo empresarial, no conocía a ningún otro empresario, o sea, nuevamente yo tenía 21, 22 años, o sea, ¿qué tipo de empresarios vas a conocer en tu círculo en esa época? Y esto definitivamente, la colaboración, ser vulnerable, traer a otros a la conversación, make you feel like you belong here, then it plays definitely a role.
So we're waiting for Gustavo here that's letting us into his house today.
Oh, Jose! I thought you were lying about coming to my house.
Welcome.
Hey, guess what? I have empanadas and aguardiente. So I think that this is a good place for you to be.
Traigo sed y hambre. Entonces, this is going to work out.
I'm sorry that we have the dogs and the baby, but please.
What is that?
Oh, this is a family portrait.
It looks just like you.
Yeah. Okay, so we are here. This is where all the meals get prepared.
Awesome. Oh, and you have some puppies.
Welcome, I'm so happy that you're here.
Oh, yeah. These ones are like, oh, Toby.
Hey, buddy.
Julia. She's a little older, but she's actually the love of the house.
Bueno, Quiero saber ahora de tu bandera latinoamericana. Como dijimos, es de Colombia. Y pues, ¿qué tenemos aquí enfrente de nosotros?
Ay. Muchos problemas, yo creo, durante esta entrevista. ¿Quién sabe qué voy a terminar diciendo?
Ok.
Pero bueno, la idea es poder revelar secretos y secretos íntimos y poder entrar en el calor de nuestro hogar. Okay. Aguardiente.
Ok. Y esta...
Si tú tienes un amigo colombiano y un amigo colombiano no te ha introducido al aguardiente... sí, yo creo que revisaría el pasaporte para ver si es colombiano o no.
Ok, entonces, ¿para qué ocasiones sacamos esto?
¿Para qué ocasiones no sacamos el aguardiente? Creo que es la pregunta. El aguardiente, pues, es una bebida muy típica de nuestra cultura colombiana y es uno de estos elementos que culturalmente nos hace sentir orgullosos alrededor del mundo, especialmente cuando salimos. De por sí, aguardiente en Colombia, cuando vives en Colombia, de pronto tiendes a decir, no, mejor voy a tomar whisky. Okay. Por un tema de estatus, ¿verdad? Okay. Ya cuando sales de Colombia es cuando temas como el vallenato y temas como el aguardiente te van a conectar más por ser diferente.
Ok, y pues yo nomás conozco como del tequila y del mezcal siendo de México. ¿Hay una región específica de donde sacan el aguardiente en Colombia o...?
Yo creo que tenemos diferentes regiones. Sé que el Valle del Cauca produce muy buen aguardiente. Tenemos pues Cali. También tenemos el aguardiente antioqueño, ¿sí? Que pues es de la región de Medellín, que todos escuchamos y conocemos como una de las ciudades más innovadoras del mundo.
¿Por qué innovadoras?
Bueno, esto es realmente algo súper, súper interesante. Innovadoras porque pasó de ser la ciudad más violenta del mundo, ¿sí? Con el mayor número de muertes diarias debido al pasado triste que tenemos en Colombia, a pasar a ser una de las ciudades de mayor innovación en Latinoamérica y en el mundo.
Okay. ¿Sí?
Pues fue la única ciudad que prometió poner metro y cumplió en Colombia. La única ciudad en todo Colombia que tiene metro. ¿Sí? Ni siquiera la capital, ni siquiera en Colombia. En Colombia se ha prometido por generaciones.
¿Y cuando dices metro, el para el
metro,
transporte?
El método de transporte.
Ok, porque sí, aquí conocemos el metro, pero no sé cómo si se llamaba igual.
Un metro literalmente como en Europa o como en Nueva York, en Washington. Y lo interesante es que tú visitas el metro hoy, después de más de 20 años, y si yo te dijera, el metro lo pusieron ayer, ¿tú lo crees? Así de limpio y así de fuerte... es la cultura, especialmente en Medellín, por un tipo de sentido de pertenencia bastante, bastante fuerte.
Okay. ¿Sí?
Y esto lo arrancaron pues desde los niños.
Ya te
entiendo. Lo arrancaron desde ir a crear educación, ir a fomentar cariño por tu propia ciudad y por lo tuyo desde las comunidades.
Sí, bueno, toma aguardiente.
Vamos a ver, por acá.
Ahí. Le poquito.
Sí, le pones un poquito de limón. Sí.
A mí me encanta el limón.
Y ya. Y lo tomas.
¿Y una forma de tomártelo nomás?
No, ya, pues así directo al punto.
Lo hacemos como tequila entonces.
Salud.
Salud.
Pues
gracias,
por
TECH23. TECH23, TECH23, Colombia y pues la innovación que sigue en Colombia también.
Por supuesto.
Ok, so. My American taste buds taste licorice.
Okay.
It's like the little strong candy that's like dark colored. It has a little bitter licorice taste too.
That every time we say something, you need to take some aguardiente. So, you know, at the same time, it's kind of like making people...
Every time we say tech. Okay, every time we say tech. Ok, Gustavo, entonces ahora hay que hablar de la música. A mí me fascina la música colombiana, especialmente las cumbias. Yo sé que México tiene de raíz las cumbias de Colombia y hay una historia atrás de eso. Entonces, ¿me puedes hablar más de la cumbia y la música y luego nos presentas qué tienes aquí?
Bueno, realmente entrar ya al punto como historiador, ¿no? Ajá. Pues las historias que a mí me contaron durante pues, mi niñez y demás... pues la cumbia es una de esas de esos géneros musicales muy fuertes dentro de la cultura colombiana. Viene desde nuestros indígenas, también viene de toda la migración, por ejemplo, de esclavos, los mestizos, y bueno, todo. De ahí se empezó a desarrollar. El acordeón es parte, pues, de la música colombiana. Lo traemos un poquito más para acá. Ajá. Pero el acordeón, si te das cuenta, pues es una marca Hohner, es una marca alemana, ¿sí? Entonces tú dices, espérate, pero ¿cómo así un acordeón alemán y en Colombia? Entonces, parte de esta migración lo que hizo fue que nos ayudó a traer sonidos a la cultura colombiana, y nosotros mismos empezamos a jugar con los... con los diferentes ruidos y demás, y a crear nuestra propia música, pues basado en nuestro folclore. Y el acordeón, pues hoy en día tenemos el vallenato originario, Valledupar, sí, hay una ciudad en Colombia que se llama Valledupar, tenemos un festival de vallenato que es grandísimo, y ya países, y está dentro de mi, dentro de mi lista, y hay países, por ejemplo, como Venezuela, en donde también el vallenato es muy bien recibido, y tenemos pues cantantes como Carlos Vives que han llevado el vallenato alrededor del mundo. Bueno, en fin, está ahí muchísimo detrás.
¿Lo tienes de decoración o lo sabes tocar tú?
Bueno, siendo consistente en mi historia y hasta ahorita voy entendiendo un poco, de manera orgánica puedo decir, el ser diferente siempre lo he resaltado. Entonces, cuando llegué a Estados Unidos, no tenía amigos, no hablaba el idioma, ¿de qué manera conectaba? Y empecé a ir a unos juegos de fútbol en high school. Y pues tú sabes que si es fútbol, pues es latino, y la gente empieza a hacer ruido y demás. Entonces yo dije, no, espérate. Uno, no tengo novia. Dos, no tengo amigas. Tres, no conozco a nadie. Pues de alguna manera tengo que conectar. Claro, llevé una caja vallenata.
¿Qué es una caja vallenata?
Una caja vallenata. Déjame, te voy a mostrar ahorita en un momentico que es una caja vallenata. Pero es un tambor. Y después pues me di cuenta que eso traía pues una atención gigantísima a la gente. Y después dije, voy a traerme un acordeón. Y me traje un acordeón de Colombia y empecé a, pues, como a practicar y demás. Hasta que pues saqué algunas canciones. Y pues ya es, o sea, cualquier lugar donde fuera, sacaba el acordeón, y ya después de unos aguardientes y
ya
todo,
tocabas mejor, pues, se escuchaba mejor.
Entonces aquí, ¿cuál es el mensaje? El mensaje es no tener pena de nuestras raíces, no tener pena de nuestra historia, pero más bien hacer uso de lo que nos hace diferentes.
100%.
Sí, reflexionar en esto, traerlo al frente, y la magia va a suceder automáticamente.
¿Cómo se escucha esto? ¿Un poquito diferente o esto no se...?
Sí. Sí, de por sí, no sé si tengamos tiempo, pero bueno, no quiero ahorita entrar a...
Nomás un ruido, nomás que soy.
¿Un ruido? A ver si ponemos un ruido. Ojalá nuestro director de producción no nos regañe. Decir, esto no era parte del plan. Pero sí.
Ok.
¿Ya?
Gracias. Sí, entonces es similar porque pues en México también usan el acordeón para mucha música. Y pues sí, México y Colombia siempre han estado pues muy cerquitos en la cultura. Y como mexicano, a veces escuchamos a los colombianos decir unas frases. Nosotros tenemos las de nosotros también. ¿Qué son unas frases or like slang terms that colombianos use here so that we know if like maybe you're talking bad about me or not, or you're just like saying something friendly? So what are some of the top slang terms that colombianos use here in the United States?
Wow. So I want to make sure that I use the good words and not the bad words.
Yes.
So we actually have words that they can mean 20 different things depending on the context that you use. But let's say, for example, berraco.
Okay.
You know, berraco.
I have no idea what that means, so.
Good.
Educate me.
We actually use it a lot. You know, you gotta do things with berraquera. Tienes que hacer cosas con berraquera. Con berraquera, it means with grit, right?
Con
with
ganas.
Energy, con ganas, con ganas, right?
Okay, use it in a sentence.
Hay que meterle berraquera.
Hay que meterle ganas.
That's hay que meterle ganas. Translation. Right. Hay que meterle ganas. Hay que meterle berraquera. And that term, a lot of us, we grew up with those words.
Okay.
And that is just a reminder that as Latinos and Hispanics, we know that we come from communities where things are rough, to where we need to earn our place. But at the end of the day, we have this berraquera. We have this ganas. And nobody's going to be able to compete against that.
Okay. So if I go to a Colombian restaurant, where we just at, and if I say, man, el chef hizo esta comida con berraquera. then they'll like
absolutely they will understand.
Okay, sounds good, sounds good. Okay.
Parcero es otra.
Oh, sí,
parcero, si es parcero es en todo lugar.
So, hablando ahora de the tech.
Do you know what's going to happen? Yeah, keep going.
Okay, hablando de tech, media and technology. So, yo también cuando pienso tecnología y media, pues obviamente el estreno grandísimo que la versión de ustedes de Coco fue la de Encanto. Mm-hmm. Y ahí aprendí yo mucho de la Colombian customs too. Mm-hmm. I'm curious what you, as a Colombian, what your thoughts were about it. What did you like? What did you not like? And what if you ever shoot a movie, what could you do better?
Well, I want to be as short as possible, and uh-huh. I get really passionate about this, and time in media, it's uh-huh. expensive.
Bueno,
but salud. The majority of Colombians, hardworking people, sí. Honest people, people with berraquera, and unfortunately we were with this stamp in our passport, yeah. Of
sí, el pasado.
El pasado. We're talking about Pablo Escobar, mm-hmm. Cartel de Medellín, Cartel mm-hmm. de Cali, to where everywhere we were going, mm-hmm. It was funny to say, oh, so how's the coca down there?
Yeah.
Sí. And that was like literally for us, for sí. Colombians, for anybody listening sí. out there, do not.
Yeah.
It's not funny, right? And then, you know, over the years, we start showing the Shakiras. We start showing sí. the Carlos Vives. Mm-hmm. We start winning El Tour de Francia. Sí. And all these things that yeah. Colombians, like, literally leading sí. NASA.
El café.
Sí. Like, you know, did you know that actually we're selling café to Apple, to Facebook, to Microsoft?
No, but that's
somebody
awesome.
I know, I'm very proud. Also okay. a friend that I have. Amazing. So all of these Colombians who are doing amazing things yeah. all over the world. And then guess what? Netflix, boom, they yeah. come and they have Narcos, they have yeah. El Patron del Mal and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And we're like, after so many years,
yeah.
why, yeah. why? So yes, this is very important for us to start taking ownership of leadership, to start mm-hmm. taking ownership of asking to be part of the boardrooms, to be part of the executive gotcha. Level, because we represent these Latinos, sí. we represent the Colombianos,
100%.
And we gotta do it the way, and I'm gonna take the example of Disney. Mm-hmm. So look at the two differences that we have right sí. here. One of them, we're selling the bad stuff.
De drogas at Disney.
And that's what sells. I get it.
Yeah.
And then there is the other one selling Encanto.
Sí.
Which I don't know if you watch Encanto.
I did right? like so many times. Yeah.
And I remember, you know, the moment of the grandma, we all connect to it sí. and the struggle mm-hmm. and she sacrificed her entire life. I was yeah. literally like sitting right next to my wife and I'm like.
Yeah. Sí. So that was the moment for the Colombianos, porque en Coco, para el mexicano, era también la abuelita. It's interesting. Ponen la familia, sí.
Well, imagine a woman that never lived her own life.
Yeah.
They live the life with their kids.
100%. Sí.
And their grandkids.
Yeah.
They never went to Europe. They never went to like, oh, yeah. I'm going to go to the nightclub. Mm-hmm. Or, well, there's, you know, de pronto una abuelita yeah. aquí y allá, sí. pero...
¿Cómo se llama? Carne de res o Andrés Carne de res.
Andrés Carne de res. Yeah.
That's the only
thing. That's a restaurant. Yeah, that's a restaurant that you need to go to whenever you go to Bogota. But yeah, so it's our job now. The past is the past, and we're not here to blame yeah. anyone or whatnot, to make sure that we bring that message that Latinos are good people, that Latinos are improving yeah. economy and building a better future
yeah.
for all.
Yeah, and that's, you know, honestly, glad you said that, porque con TECH23 es lo que queremos hacer. Es... to shine the light on you, mm-hmm. Colombiano, empezando una empresa latina, taking on, maybe not strictly competing against them, but you're building a tech company para darle mucho...
You're building a what?
A tech
okay, company. Okay, well, I'll let you pass okay. this way.
You're building a tech company para darle mucho empleo a muchas diferentes personas. Mm-hmm. Y a liderazgo va a estar un colombiano que entiende desde que estabas arreglando estéreos en carros. Desde que nunca se te va a olvidar, yo sé, el momento de tu mamá que... innovación y tenía su carbón ahí para hacerles una sopita de arroz. Mm-hmm. Like, that's, I think, si todos pudiéramos empezar con esa historia, todos los latinos juntos, hey, yo tengo, esta es mi historia, es mi mamá con su sopa de arroz. Para mí, luego te cuento también, fue una historia cuando no podía pagar mis, my textbooks for college. My mom, like, just did an amazing thing and she was selling some of her jewelry. So that like I could have money for my textbooks, and when she finally told me that like years later, I was like, what? But it's el amor de una mamá, ¿verdad? Like, I think that's moms all over the world. But if we all connect with that story, I think we would just, like, really surpass and, like, pues, empezamos a salir adelante, ¿verdad? Porque qué bueno que Dios te está bendiciendo y que estás creciendo la compañía. Y, pues, como dijiste, 15 años todo era de just trying. And one thing led to
another. And being broke. And being having overdraft fees.
Yeah.
And, like, literally not knowing if you're going to make it next week.
Yeah.
And how do you face employees on Friday and say, like, hey, I'm sorry, your check is going to bounce. Let me pay you on Monday.
Yeah.
So being put in those situations, it really builds up on, let's just be humans, right?
Yeah.
Let's not wait until we have a natural disaster to be humans.
100%.
And to connect with those stories.
Yeah.
So whenever we have external factors like religion, like politics, like so on and so on and so on, hey, we are all human. What can we do to better our race?
Yeah.
What can we do? What can I do to help you and to help your organization? Mm-hmm. And I think the moment that we start understanding this, that it's about me believing in your cause and your vision and empowering you, then that's whenever things magically happen.
So let's use that, what you just said. ¿Cómo te está ayudando eso entonces ahorita con Trez? And it's for the success of Trez.
Well, Trez, I mean, payroll is payroll. I mean, I'm not gonna bore you with, like, well, this is the technology and this is what we're doing, and let me just talk to you about the UX and the UI and whatnot, because payroll is payroll. But the moment I'm telling you that we are stepping in on behalf of the Latino community, that we are Houstonians, that we are Hispanic, that we are Colombians, and we keep just going into identifying with this community, over 70 million Latinos, invisible Latinos, the majority, invisible small businesses, over 5 million and the fastest growing segment. And I'm telling you that we're building a product that represent us, because a lot of organizations out there, they say, yeah, we're serving the Latino community, but are you really? And the first question that I ask executives, especially at the C-suite, is like, how many Latino board members do we have in your organization?
And what's
and
the
you know the reaction? They put
it?
Their head down because they know they're failing. So then I meet other organizations that are helping Latinos like you, like me, so we can grow, so we can learn from them, so we can also be part eventually of Fortune 100, Fortune 500, Fortune 10 boardrooms.
Yeah.
Right? Because we need that representation in the Latino community. So Trez, this Latino payroll platform, the first Latino payroll platform, what it does is creating that sense of ownership. This is not my payroll platform. We're not here because of the money. We're here to serve and represent the Latino small businesses, because we know how difficult it is out there. We know that whenever you're starting a business, there is a lot of people around you that want you to fail. And you're alone.
Yeah.
And the faster you grow, the lonelier it gets. So we want to be that platform that is here for you to tell you that you're not alone.
I love what you said about que no es nomás para ti, but it's like for all of us, because I think that's what the secret is. Because like I was recently looking at a musical artist, hip hop artist that is from Africa, moved to the United States. He's like first generation from Nigeria. His success right now is being loved by his country, porque se siente like we're all moving forward. Like you're one of us. You're very transparent and open. And I think that's what we need to continue to do. Be very transparent and open about the struggles para que el resto de México, el resto de Colombia, el resto de Latinoamérica se sienta, hey, estamos llegando hacia adelante. Hoy es él, mañana quizás pueda ser yo en esos lugares. So, Gustavo, I mean, thank you so much for sharing with us today. We had empanadas, we had café, we heard you a little microsecond play el acordeón, we had aguardiente con poquito limón, y pues gracias que nos dejaste entrar a tu casa hoy. I know that this is where the ideas and everything goes, and you know, we go out there into the corporate world, into different worlds, and do our best, and then we come back to our house, and this is sometimes where we stress out, and when we connect with our family, with God, with whatever it is that you find peace at, and you gave us access to this space. Thank you so much. Te lo agradezco.
No, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Y pues, para cerrar, ya. Porque dijimos tech como un millón de veces.
Yeah, no, that's true. No, thank you so much for the opportunity. I think that what you guys are doing here is something beautiful, is something genuine. And I think that's whenever startups and businesses start making sense. When you're not doing it just because of the profits,
sí.
But you're doing it because of a mission. And we need to let others out there know
sí.
That, yeah, the struggle is real and the struggle goes every single day, but you're not alone. And it's okay. At the end of the day, sí. Everything is going to get fixed and everything will be okay. So we're here for you and we're here gracias. For everybody.
Gracias. Y amigos, hoy celebramos con Gustavo de Colombia. En el futuro queremos que todos los países, todas las banderas de Latinoamérica sepan que estamos con ustedes. Vamos a enseñar más personas como Gustavo para que sepan que él es como yo, ella es como yo y la están haciendo, ustedes también pueden. So, salud para todo Latinoamérica.
Gracias.